find it amazing, the stereotypes that we give to certain instruments. Is the violin used just to make classical music? No. Well, what about the saxophone? Is it just a jazz horn? Well, don't jump to that conclusion either. We're going to have a look at the classical side of the saxophone today on A Note to You. I'm Virginia Eskin. It's been 160 years since the saxophone was invented, but it still is new to the concert stage. It has a very remarkable history. And today on our program, we have a virtuoso saxophone player, William Street. He's in demand as a soloist with orchestras and chamber groups throughout North America, and he's a fine recitalist as well. He teaches at the University of Alberta in Edmonton, Canada. How did you get turned on to the sax?
Well, Virginia, it was quite a while ago, in these my latter years already. But
look latter to me. You look very handsome.
I got quite excited early on by one of my early music teachers, really. I was studying music in my school band program. My parents encouraged me to get involved in that. And a tuba player by the name of George Duman was the band director, and he encouraged his students in such a way that I was really taken with it. And eventually, through some private lessons and encouragement of his and aspiring to ever more challenges that mm-hmm. he put ahead of us, I just found it fascinating. Eventually, I heard recordings of some saxophone, which just amazed me, and it really stuck in my ear.
Well, let's hear something very beautiful for the sax. You've chosen the Rhapsody by Debussy.
One of my favorites.
Thank you.
We just heard the Rhapsody by Debussy, played by Jean-Marie Londex, with the orchestra of the Luxembourg Radio, Louis de Froment conducting. Well, let's go back to the history, Bill, of the saxophone.
Well, the history isn't as long as we think, and that's probably why we perceive the saxophone we do today. We have a little more than 150 years of history for the saxophone, which compared to the oboe and the ancient times that we might have played double reeds, it's not particularly long. It was an instrument which was conceived and invented by Adolf Sax.
But Berlioz heard the sax, so it goes back to the beginning of the 19th century.
Well, this would be in the 1840s that he would have heard it. And about that time he heard it, he was quite impassioned by it. The first piece that was actually performed by the saxophone was a piece written by Berlioz. In fact, it's called Hymne Sacré, Sacred Hymn. And it was, strange enough, it was a transcription of a choral piece that Berlioz had written. And it incorporated the instruments that Sax had invented, of which one was saxophone.
And Adolf Sax was a Belgian.
He was a Belgian. I mean, actually, the lines are very gray back at that time, but he was a Belgian who came to live in Paris, and he had a manufacturing of instruments. He was also an inventor. He invented a lot of things other than the saxophone, including the train whistle.
In that way, he's like Joseph Hoffman, who invented the brakes on trains.
Well, I think people back in those days, they were engineers and thinkers, and we're trying many things. The same thing is true of the flute manufacturers early on. We're inventors as well.
Right. You have this sort of wonderful story you were telling me in the car about this Boston lady.
Well, when the saxophone was first invented in the mid-1800s, 1840-ish, it was taught by Adolf Sax until he died in the 90s, 1890s.
In France,
at the Paris Conservatory. But not long after that, there was a Boston woman by the name of Elise Hall, who, on the advice of, in fact, her husband, took up the saxophone as an instrument and became a patron of the arts for the saxophone.
And he was a doctor?
Her husband, Dr. Richard Hall, was in fact, the first person who ever diagnosed appendicitis, apparently.
Oh.
Unfortunately, he died of appendicitis because no one else recognized it.
Oh.
So he was also instrumental in developing the use of local anesthetic. And unfortunately, he became addicted to the cocaine that he was experimenting with as well. So there are some quite extensive and interesting articles in a short book that I've written about Elise Hall that really go into this quite a lot. But eventually she became so interested in the saxophone, and particularly because she had been born in Paris from of a Boston family.
You mentioned the Coolidge name. That's
right.
An old she's fancy Boston.
About a seventh cousin of the president, I figured out at one point, but very closely related to quite a well-to-do family.
Wonderful.
And she eventually used her inheritance to support the saxophone by commissioning works for it, including
and
the Debussy.
And she learned to play it herself, you said.
She learned to play it, and of a quite a good standard. She played with orchestras in France and played over 20 concerts here in Boston, where she played in either Copley Hall or in Jordan Hall many
times.
Have
you ever gone to the clipping file at our big Boston Public Library?
Of course. I've done extensive research on the Orchestra Club of Boston, and she had she was quite instrumental in their development in the early years.
And I asked what she looked like, and you gave a sort of delicious description.
Well, the photos I have, there are very few photos, but I know her granddaughter, who's still living, Charlotte Salisbury, and she was at one time a model for Vogue, a very beautiful woman. And her mother was very elegant looking, and in photos she has a very regal looking personage.
I've done similar research with women of ragtime, and they wear big feather boa hats and
tiny
waists.
Large hoop skirts.
Yeah.
And
romantic.
And very romantic and really exotic when you put a saxophone in the hands of the woman at the same time.
Hard to imagine. You've chosen now sort of an interesting piece. Can you tell us something about Scaramouche?
Scaramouche was a piece written by Darius Milhaud.
What year, approximately?
1937-ish, around there.
Before he went to live in Berkeley.
Yes, before that. He would have actually had some experience being in South America already.
That's right.
And he'd actually written a much more important, influential piece before this, which was probably the first important piece orchestral piece that allied jazz and classical music together, the La Création du Monde, Creation of the World. He incorporates the saxophone into the orchestra and also has it used as a solo. But in Scaramouche, there are two versions of Scaramouche that are very well known. The one that often people think is, because it's the most famous, is the two-piano version.
Right.
But the original one for that is really the saxophone and orchestra, and eventually saxophone and piano version, I think, which we're going to hear today, the saxophone and piano.
What is it? What does it stand for? Something I've forgotten.
Scaramouche. It has to do with the théâtre Scaramouche, the Scaramouche theater in France, and it was
like Comédie Française.
Exactly, except for it was an imitation of the Italian comedy.
Thank you.
We just heard Scaramouche by Darius Milhaud, played by Jürgen Demmler, saxophone player. And we have in the studio a saxophone expert. Do you like to be called Dr. Street?
Oh, I think Bill is fine, Virginia.
We have this sort of interesting little quote from Berlioz, because I love the idea that somebody as old as Berlioz was aware of the saxophone, because most people, if you pulled the man in the street and asked him when was the sax invented, he probably would say the 20s or the 30s, because it, you know, it's always associated with swing music, certainly in America.
Well, I think probably recordings have a lot to do with it. The recordings that we have available and the earliest recordings we can hear.
Well, and the image of the sax, Bill, you know, with this very seductive instrument, the way it's, the bell of it, and then
it's been incorporated a lot in the visual arts. It's been incorporated
incredibly
as a very sexy image, and it's been used such.
It's very hot, as they say in advertising. I mean, they use the piano to sell cars, you know, lingerie, perfume, wine, and the saxophone is right up there in terms of image. Well, Berlioz, he says here in this quote that the sound of the saxophone is similar to that of the bass clarinet. And it's full, soft, extremely powerful, and easy to lower in intensity. Sounds good, doesn't it? Like a frying up a clove of garlic.
Well, the first instrument that he actually would have heard would have been the baritone saxophone, and it was actually referred to as a bass saxophone in those years.
They didn't realize that there was going to be a whole...
Well, there was really a whole family created at the same time in theory, and then eventually they were manufactured.
Adolf Sax is the first inventor, and then does it spread out like the evolution of the clarinet, where they have different types?
Well, that's a whole history in another direction.
But these
instruments were patented. There were B flat and E flat instruments and C and F instruments. They were patented, and for the rest of Adolf Sax's life, from 1840 until 1897, he in fact was in lawsuits where he was being sued or suing over the patents of his instruments. So other people did try to make them, apparently, according to him, inferior instruments. But coming back to Berlioz was not the only one of that era. Rossini also wrote for the saxophone and used it in one of his early pieces. Unfortunately, it's a piece that's been lost. But you can see that there's some well-known composers early on who
there's
championed.
There's a trip to Italy there in your future.
I've been once to look, but I haven't found it yet.
Where would one begin? I guess you'd been...
Well, I'd go to Pesaro, and that's the birthplace of Rossini, where he left his estate to the city of Pesaro, who created a theater, Rossini Theater.
Yes.
Beautiful theater. And it would be a very important contribution to the literature if we could find such a piece.
All right. I'm Virginia Eskin, and you're listening to A Note to You. If you have comments about the saxophone or anything else on our program, we love to hear from you. The address is A Note to You, care of WGBH Radio, 125 Western Avenue, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. The email address is anotetoyou@wgbh.org. And if you write, let us know the name of your radio station. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. I'm speaking with virtuoso saxophone player Bill Street, who's visiting us from Canada. We're up to about 1909?
Well, Elise Hall lived until 1924. She was probably active until about 1919 or so. But in the active side of the performance of saxophone, another person was already taking off a little bit in Europe, a Danish saxophonist by the name of Sigurd Rascher.
And Rudy Widhoff?
Oh, Rudy Widhoff, of course. We can't forget him in North America. And he, in fact, was one of the most incredible virtuosos of the saxophone in the 20s and in the 30s. His recordings are still, they're obscure, but you can find them. And his music is available often at yard sales and old libraries. You can find some of his music.
Really?
He wrote all the music that he played.
Uh-huh.
And he played with a technique that would equal anyone of today's ability to play. He was quite noted for his double and triple tonguing, but also quite an erudite man, and he wrote a number of articles and tried to teach people what he was able to do himself. And he was literally the Rolling Stones figures of the Mick Jagger
mm-hmm.
of his era.
An icon.
Very much so.
We've legitimized the saxophone today. My guest, Bill Street, a fine player who's in the studio. Lester Young certainly is a well-known player. How do you stand on him, Bill?
Oh, one of the greatest jazz players of all time.
Ever met him?
No, not in my time period, really. But really, certainly one of the pivotal and influential people in saxophone. And
because of his sound,
exactly,
rather than his technique. I think as players evolved, the beautiful quality of sound.
Well, I'm impressed, even with the instruments of the 30s and 40s, what beautiful sound and beautiful technique these players played with.
I'd like us to hear a little bit of Lester Young. That was Lester Young with I Never Knew. So what's happening on the saxophone front today?
Well, certainly today, lots of North American composers are
you brought
writing
an interesting CD in.
Well, Helio Saxo is a CD I've recently done.
Helio means
Helio
Greek.
Means, it's Greek to the sun.
Yeah.
The saxophone of the sun is the translation,
nice,
I suppose.
Nice pun.
That piece includes a lot of contemporary music of North America and of France. Composers like Bill Karlins from Chicago.
When you studied at Northwestern, is that when you met him?
That's when I met him, but certainly I'd known his music before that.
I listened to that piece on your CD for the two saxes.
That would be by Bill Karlins, yes.
I like that piece.
Good.
We had a little chance to listen to it. Let's hear a little bit of that. We just had a little sampling of a piece by Bill Karlins called Introduction and Passacaglia. We're going to go out on a piece of our guest Bill Street's latest CD by John Harbison, who lives here in Boston and is a good friend of this station. His music is often played.
I've not met Mr. Harbison yet, but I've corresponded with
Charming
him.
Charming man.
He's written me a very kind letter and appreciated the CD.
He's very supportive, and he's a great teacher. He is very friendly with his students at MIT.
And he wrote a great piece. This is a great piece in the repertoire of saxophone.
Let's hear it. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was music by John Harbison, played by our guest, Bill Street, who's been visiting us from Canada. And what an enjoyable program, and I hope that all of us are the wiser and nobody will make any stupid remarks about the saxophone just being a jazz instrument, because it certainly isn't. And if you think of it being around, as you said, for like 150 years, it puts it in a different time context, Bill. Maybe it's if Schubert had written something, or, you know, if we had a little, like we have with the clarinet, we have the Brahms and the Mozart, that helps to...
I think if composers hear it more, they'll write more for it. They need to know what its possibilities are.
Exactly. And I think you're in the vanguard. People who play something very, very well spark a composer to write a beautiful piece or an exploitive piece.
It challenges it both ways. It pushes us farther, and sure, it's very interesting for us all.
Well, thank you very much for coming in.
It's been a pleasure to be here with you, Virginia. Thank you.
Well, we have a few minutes left, and I'd like to share with you a good example of crossover music for saxophone. This is the Vocalise by Rachmaninoff, played by Branford Marsalis.
Thank you.
We just heard the Vocalise by Rachmaninoff, played by Branford Marsalis on saxophone, and he was backed up by the English Chamber Orchestra with Andrew Litton conducting. Our engineers today have been Alan Mattis and Ray Fallon. Our producer is Alan McClellan, and we have a production assistant, Andrea Lieber, here. I'm Virginia Eskin, and you've been listening to A Note to You. It's made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. It's produced by Northeastern University in cooperation with WGBH Radio, Boston.